For more on the implications of the anti-terrorism laws, implementing rules and regulations, we now have with us Attorney Edre Olalia. He's the president of the National Union of People's Lawyers. Good morning, Attorney Olalia, and thank you for joining us on the program.
Hi, good morning again, Christian. Good morning to everybody.
Okay, the IRR, did it actually clarify certain vague provisions of the law, or did it just confirm perhaps your worst fears?
No, it did not clarify. As a matter of fact, it was a vain attempt to prettify the law and salvage the infirmities in the law, which is not allowed. It was a disingenuous way to cure what is already in the law itself.
But of course, that cannot be done by an IRR, right? It cannot go
Certainly
beyond
not.
What the law says.
Yes, you are correct, because as we already have said time and again, the water cannot rise above its source. So anything that comes from a polluted source is also polluted in a sense.
But in this case, when you saw the IRR, what did you find most disturbing?
Well, there are a lot, Christian, but brevity, well, one, of course, it adopted in the first place and reproduced the questionable concept and definition and the provisions of the law itself, even expanded, enlarged, and extended, and worse, it sneaked in certain provisions which were not in the law.
Like what provisions?
Well, at least three of those provisions, one of which is the expansion of the potential that a advocacy strike dissent may be considered as an act of terrorism, because under the law, Section 4, it limited the exclusion of the exemption to three instances: death, bodily injury, and serious danger to public safety. Now, in the implementing rules, it included the other provisions of the law, which refers to the purpose of the act. Secondly, it also sneak in possibility that despite the absence of any written authorization, which we are questioning in the first place, yeah, that a person can be detained more than the customary or allowable periods of detention of maximum of 36 hours. And thirdly, it expanded what material support means. There is a definition there that is not included in the law, which refers to information regarding the surroundings, communities of a possible terrorist attack, and also what a humanitarian organization that can be exempted from the vulnerability of material support. There are many others, but this can exemplify what my point.
So are you saying that the IRR has gone beyond what the law states?
Yes, Christian, obviously. And we just mentioned three of those provisions that are very alarming and very worrying.
But in this case, what do they intend to do with the IRR, if this indeed was the case?
Well, of course, as you very well know, we are counsels for a petition pending in the Supreme Court. So I will refrain in abundance of caution to telegraph whatever specific legal moves we are going to do. But in general, of course, it is open to challenge, and then we're going to consider those options.
Okay, but isn't the clarification under Rule 4.4, acts not considered terrorism, it identified activities such as advocacy, protest, dissent. They will not be considered as terrorist activities or terrorism. But of course, we know that there is a condition set here. Basically, they won't be considered as terrorism if they are not meant, for example, to cause death or serious physical harm. I mean, how could this be misused? For example, in the case of leftist activists.
Well, you don't even have to be a leftist activist to start with, any ordinary citizen. We handled a case of the security guard. You can look it up. Rolly Panessa. He was an ordinary security guard. He was alleged to be a commander of the NPA. He was tortured and was in prison for 9 full months before he was released on habeas corpus. But my point is, the problem here is not only because of this provision, but because of the concept. Why? Because the law itself says, and it is replicated in the implementing rules, it focuses on the intention and the purpose. And there is no specific act. Unlike, we're not conceding the Human Security Act, but at least in the Human Security Act, there are specific predicate crimes, murder, arson, etc., kidnapping. Here, it's any act. And then they tied it up with the purpose and intention. and the purpose and intention is an internal process, right? And it can be interpreted differently by different people under different circumstances because it is subjective. And worse, the problem is in reality by a mere malicious, reckless imputation that your act, whatever it is, speech, emblem, whatever, advocacy, is intended, allegedly, for the purpose, allegedly, so that it starts the ball rolling already. You can be arrested and designated, and then the damage has already been done. Mm. So that is the problem, because the focus is on the intention and the purpose, rather than on a concrete, specific act, with, of course, conceding the definition itself, Christian.
Yeah, I understand that. That is a very... alarming concern here. Now, speaking of the power to designate, that was one of the issues that that has been raised mostly against the anti-terrorism law, the power to designate given to the Anti-Terrorism Council, which is composed of cabinet officials. But in this case, you see a procedure outlined in the IRR that there has to be a process, the names will be published of designated individuals or groups. Does it actually help? Especially that there's now a process of having yourself delisted, at least within 2 weeks after publication.
No, it doesn't help. It doesn't inspire confidence, it doesn't inspire trust. Why? Because to start with, as you already mentioned, the composition of the council is already suspect, so to speak, no? Because they are the very same individuals who go to town red-tagging individuals and organizations. So to start with, there's already a problem. Secondly, it can be arbitrary because the definition of probable cause, they use the word probable cause, but to be precise, you know what probable cause means in the implementing rules? Probable cause is still means reasonable ground for suspicion. Of course, the extended is supported by circumstances warranting a cautious person to believe that the designee meets the requirement. But you can already see again that it is still based on suspicion. So the poor fellow or the organization, without it or he or she knowing it, is already out there. In his name or her name is already in the newspapers all over town. And then the stigma, the damage, the investigation by AMLAC, the freezing, and then the possible criminal prosecution has already come into play.
Or the possible killing.
And then you have only 15 days, Christian, if I may just proceed my point. Yeah. I'm sorry for interrupting.
Sure.
And you only have 15 days. In other words, after 15 days, you are stopped or precluded from questioning the designation. So there are fundamental reasons why this does not inspire any trust or confidence at any rate.
And speaking of that two-week window during which a person is allowed to... make use of that process of delisting. A lot of things, as you've mentioned, can happen, including possible death or physical harm on that person.
Exactly, Christian, and that has been reflected and supported by reality.
But how exactly do you go about going after terrorists? We know that there has to be a delicate balance between protecting human rights and also trying to cope with the need to go after actual terrorists. I mean, how do you do that? Because this issue has a lot to do with the lack of trust, right?
Mm-hmm. Not only a lack of trust, but a lack of respect for basic rights, no? And the Constitution itself. Because, for instance, the written authority, even after an arrest, without a written authority, we're already questioning the written authority issued by the ATC. Mm-hmm. Now, the implementing rules even allowed a warrantless arrest, purportedly because of the existing rules of procedure, but they can extend it by a mere sworn statement, no?
The affidavit.
And which is an affidavit, which is can be unreliable, can be manufactured, and based on our experience, can be produced by professional witnesses. And I have to note, you have to note, Christian, that the penalty for perjury is very light. It's, I think, 6 months to a maximum of 2 years and 2 months compared to a life imprisonment for the penalties or at the minimum 12 years. So you can see the disparity of the between the respect for rights and the overbreadth power of the state. I don't really know. I'm not an expert on terrorism myself. I'm a lawyer. We are experts, probably, with modesty aside, on human rights. We see a violation of human rights when we see it. We know it is a violation when we see it. But we can advance the point that a good, honest-to-goodness, non-political investigation and procedure with non-rhetorical or token respect for human rights must be ensured by the law. Okay. So we are asking that certain provisions, we can parse these provisions, but in general, the framework must be, you have to respect the majority who are non-terrorists. We don't have problems with eradicating terrorism. It's hard for anyone to even advocate terrorism and say that we're supporting it because we are objecting to the law. What we're saying is that you had to be prudent, you had to take into account the rights of the people, even if we are countering terrorism.
Now, with we know that as far as this government is concerned, the New People's Army, the Communist Party of the Philippines, are considered terrorists. Now, we know the problem with red baiting. You guys have been vocal about that. Now, with the IRR now out, do you see a worsening of the situation, more arrests perhaps, now that the implementing rules and regulations are out?
Oh, Christian, kasi even without the implementing rules and the law itself, the red baiting has been vicious, relentless, and incorrigible. We already saw that even with respect to the mother in detention whose infant died. No? And you can see government officials left and right saying that, you are over-dramatizing a reality because that person anyway, that young woman anyway, is accused of being an activist, not even a terrorist. So you can extend that scenario. And I want to also add, Christian, and for the benefit of our friends in the media, they sneak in this term, creative, artistic, and cultural expressions. That is not included in the law, not in Section 4. Section 4 speaks of advocacy, stoppage of war, dissent, strike, but they included this one. And that is, according to my colleagues, and I agree, is the death knell on press freedom. Because any report, any article, even an artistic expression, whether it is spoken or nonverbal, can now be qualified. There is that provision in the rules.
I just want to clarify that. Oh yeah. Yeah, I think it's mentioned in Rule 4.4, but yes, it states here that creative, artistic, and cultural expressions are acts not considered terrorism. But again, there's a qualifier. If any of the acts enumerated in the paragraphs mentioned are intended to cause death or serious physical harm. But isn't this a safeguard enough? I mean, even if creative expression or artistic and cultural expressions were included, I mean, isn't the rule itself a safeguard?
Well, I'd like to reiterate before I go to that question, Christian. I'd like to reiterate that these rules expanded the qualifications or the exception to the exception. The general rule is that strikes, advocacy, and so on and so forth are not considered acts of terrorism.
Yeah.
The exception is that it causes death, bodily injury, and undermines public safety seriously.
Mm.
Now, as I said earlier, it even included the other purposes in the law, which is to intimidate the general public, promote or influence by intimidation the government, create or spread a message, which were not in the law itself. You have to check it out. You have to be very, very discerning as to the details of the sneak-in provision that, aside from the inclusion of the creative, artistic, and cultural expressions, and then now, going to your point, as we have said, the problem here is not only because of the abundant experience that we saw and we're seeing right now, but also even conceptually, you are looking at the intention and the purpose, not the specific act. So a police officer or a military officer or a professional witness or even an undersecretary or an assistant secretary can execute an affidavit. Because after all, the penalty for perjury is probationable. It's very light. So they can get away with it. No?
Okay.
And then you can wait until kingdom comes before any conviction can come. At the same time, it says that, we have established that your intention and purpose, despite your protestations, no, you were just exercising. But in the meantime, you're in jail. In the meantime, your assets are being investigated. In the meantime, the stigma has already been there. And all the intangible, deleterious effects of all these violations.
Okay. Attorney Edre Olalia, thank you for joining us, sir.
Ay, maraming salamat, Christian.